Thanks for joining us for this edition of To My Way of Thinking. Joining us today, gentlemen, really doesn't need that much introduction, is Tony Hill, Anthony Tony Hill. He has been involved in the community in all aspects of it. He's come up through the ranks in terms of our political, in terms of politics within Jacksonville and quite frankly throughout Northern Florida. And is currently, again, coming off of the sidelines, so to speak, as he's decided to take a shot at running for Congress, for the district that's currently held by Al Lawson, and of course has a unique history in the African-American community, as a matter of fact, as being one of the first districts that was drawn up about a decade or so ago that allowed African-Americans in Florida to go back to Congress. Because for the prior 100 or so years prior to that, roughly 2010 or something like that, there were no African-Americans represented in Congress in Florida. So the district has a unique history. And Tony has decided that he'll throw his hat in the ring to try for that again. Good morning, Tony. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you for having me, Fred.
My pleasure. Well, I mean, there's been as we take this conversation, there's been obviously a great deal of back and forth within the court system. And of course, the situation that happened initially that was spurred on by the normal decade requirement of the Florida legislature to redistrict based upon the census and all of that sort of thing to happen. The wrench that was thrown into that process, of course, is that Governor DeSantis, Ron DeSantis, decided that he would have his own input into that and draw up his own map. And the really strangely compliant legislature, Republicans principally, laid down for this and basically said, whatever you want to do, Governor, we'll do it, even though a few of them said it's not right, but the governor decided to leave his lane and basically drew up something that would have effectively diminished the African-American vote in, what's that, the 4th Congressional District?
That's correct.
All right, would have diminished the vote in that district from roughly, 45%? 50% down to less than 35% if they accepted DeSantis' map. And again, as we say today, it's been going back and forth, but apparently a judge has decided that the original map that runs from Tallahassee to Jacksonville that Lawson Al Lawson currently serves in will stand. Now, the only question I have for you is that Congressman going to change, obviously, I'm assuming by your presence here, he's not changed his mind about running. So are we good for you to be running essentially as the major Democrat in that race?
Well, based on the statement you just made, Fred, first of all, the district now will go back as is since 2016. Mm-hmm. That was drawn up by this Florida Supreme Court. So if that be the case, I will not run. But if the race that the legislature acquiesced to the governor maps that he wanted stays the same, then I will run. And that would be District 4. So right now, the judge asked that the plaintiff's attorney, I mean, not attorney, but a professor from Harvard University drew up the district. Very little changes in it. And the judge accepted it. They made the case. He said it was unconstitutional what the governor did based on the 2011 fair districting ballot initiative that was passed by the state of Florida from the constituents here in Florida. So the people in Florida said that in that piece of legislation that went into the Constitution, that no party can take away or dilute a specific group of people from electing someone to benefit their party. And of course, clearly that's what the governor did. And so now we're into a spin set of courses. The circuit court has spoke. Now it will go to the Court of Appeals. They would make a decision or they may punt the ball to the Florida Supreme Court. At the end of the day, Fred, the Supreme Court would make the final decision. I would assume that they're going to try to take a play from the playbook of the Alabama Supreme Court, where they said because of the time, because of supervisor election breathing down their throat to go ahead on and make a final decision on what the map's going to be, is to probably let that map stay the same that the governor signed off to, which would be the new congressional District 4, which will include Clay County, Duval County, and Nassau County, will stand, and then we will allow the plaintiffs on the side of the League of Women Voters, the NAACP and other groups, Black Lives Matter groups, will have their day in court. But in terms of the process moving forward, because all 26 of the 28 districts are caught up into this, congressional districts, because when you redo the maps, you're not only just doing for four, you got five and you got three in there. So in other words, you have Gainesville that had a little bit of Clay County. You had Nassau County that had a little bit of District 4, which was Rutherford now. And so all that has to be mashed out, put into play. And so right now we're in a limbo, but I would suspect, Fred, by Memorial weekend, this should be all put to bed and put to rest, and we'll know if, in fact, we're going to be running in Congressional District 4. But if it stays Congressional District 5, I will not run against the congressman.
Well, that appears to be bringing things right down to the, you know, to the last minute here, because yes. your primary is in August and
August 23rd.
Yeah, the supervisors of elections have to get their ballots ready ahead of time, and people need to be educated as to exactly who they're voting for and what district that they're in for this. Now, this is also
let me just say this too, Fred. Let's back up a little bit. When a person qualifies and pays the fees, he has to know, and that's next month, June 13th through the 17th.
Right.
So way before the 23rd of August, the supervisors have to know by next Friday. That's the drop dead date. And yeah. I think from a strategic and strategy point, part on the governor is run the clock out to back them up to say, hey, we don't have enough time. We'll just go ahead and accept what the legislature done, and we'll come back and revisit it. And that's why we are being proactive by going out last week, doing a press conference, and being prepared. As I told the reporters last week, Fred, I'm not waiting on the cavalry to come from the courts. I'm going to let the cavalry come from the people. And that's why we're running.
Well, I think that's what should happen. The only thing that's a bit puzzling to me is that this district, the current district, well, the district that we've known for the last 10 years or so that runs from Tallahassee to Jacksonville, was also part of a constitutional amendment that was put in place that essentially said that you wouldn't do anything to diminish the voting capacity of any particular group for the benefit of another, in this case, for the benefit of the Republican Party, to the non-benefit of African Americans, because not only would this district be affected, but Val Demings' seat, I think, down near Orlando area that she currently represents in Congress, although she's running for U.S. Senate against Marco Rubio primarily, would be affected. But the constitutional amendment, we're talking about a unilateral overturn also of a constitutional amendment that's been in play at some time. And you don't see, you see that that's really not going to make any difference with the court?
Well, Fred, everything is suspect and everything is based around the politics. And I'm just looking at past experience and gleaming from that is, first of all, when that district was established in 2016, the makeup of the Supreme Court was totally different. Now on that Supreme Court, the governor has placed at least three of the jurors on that court. And for them to get another vote, I think is pretty much easy to be done. And again, they're not deciding. They're just saying because of timeline, and we have to get this election on because those dates are etched in stone, qualifying the primary and the general. So they're going to set aside that and allow the maps that the governor produced to go forward. And I'm thinking that's the way it's going to go.
So you're saying the same thing in the Florida Supreme Court that we're witnessing on the, the U.S. Supreme Court.
Hello. The numbers are there.
Yep. And that's why we always say elections do make a difference. Can I give you
another one?
Go ahead.
Elections have consequences.
There you go. Elections have consequences. That's the one that I'm looking for.
Yeah, that's it.
You know, and that's what folks don't realize is that it, governors have this power to do it, and the persons that they appoint, and many folks don't pay any attention to judges until you have to go before one. But right. Appellate judges and Supreme Court judges in this case, individuals don't go before them. So we rarely get to see who they are, or even have, most people have no idea who's on the Supreme Court, the Florida Supreme Court. They don't have any idea. And their pictures are virtually never posted anywhere.
Right.
So that's correct. That's to see it. So, I mean, that's the state of our, let's move to what you would face though as Congress. What do you view as the state of our country right now?
Well, Fred, the state of the country is we're in a chaotic mood because we have baby formula. We can't get the FDA to approve these new formulas. The people that we thought were doing it, they had to abolish that or throw it out. It was defective. We have the crisis in Ukraine. We have our educational situation where people are coming out with humongous debt. We have our environmental issues. We stay in Florida. So we know about global warming. We know about the oceans and we know about the reefs. We have Social Security issues because I'm telling you, Fred, a lot of times people are calling a congressional office for about three things. One, can I get my Social Security? Some people had a gentleman one time called the office when I was working for the congressman, had a seizure, could not work anymore, and has been denied by Social Security. Well, we want to take those issues back to those agencies and connect people to them, right? We have workers' issues, the PRO Act, where you're seeing all these lockouts and stuff with baseball. All that was because there was no teeth in the law by the National Labor Relations Act to force those people on management side to come to the table and negotiate in fair. So these are some of the issues that we want to connect people to and represent them in Washington. I tell people a lot of times I'm not going up to correct people. I'm going to connect people because we got enough folks up there now correcting. That's all you're seeing every day, whether it be the abortion issue, whether it be the woke act, whether it be CRT or CLT. I mean, we got all these different things that's going on, but the folks who are sitting in that fourth congressional district, Fred, that are eating dinner at night, kitchen table issues is around Social Security, is around education, is around healthcare, it's around prescription drugs. At some versions around the state level with homeowners insurance, that's what people are trying to deal with. And most of the time, that's what they're calling the office for. So we want to be a champion to connect people. And pretty much the 26 or 27 years I've been involved in the political arena, that's what it's all been about, Fred. When they call that office, can you help me? Mm-hmm. Not send me to 10 other people, not take me around the corner, but Tony Hill. And another issue that I really have become compassionate about as a veteran and you as a veteran, Fred, is that we have a lot of women that are retiring in some cases. Some of them have did their tour of duty in the military and they're coming out, Fred, sleeping in their cars with their kids. That's just totally unacceptable. And I want to be that champion that will go to the VA, knock that door down to the VA and said, hey, why is this happening? They served, they did their time, Now it's time for us to serve them. And then from a worker standpoint, by being X number of years in the labor movement and holding titles in those different sectors, Secretary of Treasury of the Florida AFL-CIO, I want to also go back and try to put people back in charge of government instead of government in charge of people. That's what we want to do, Fred.
Well, I mean, that's quite an agenda, and it is well worth it. You have been involved in those issues for quite some time. I think I first met you when you were really into the labor movement, and to a great extent, the labor movement and the Democratic Party was fairly well aligned, as we've seen as it come through the years. Now, there's been a bit of misalignment by some of the members in the labor movement because of that. And I think that it has, from what I've been able to see, I think it's hurt the local Democratic Party a bit as we moved, especially in terms of local elections, because all of the seats here locally are held by Republicans, even though we're in a largely Democratic county that you know, nationally has voted blue, but the offices are all been red. And to a great extent, with the exception of this district, which got to be designated blue for where a Democrat, you know, was almost assured to get elected, everything surrounding us is pretty much red.
Absolutely. And
there's a possibility you could be going to Congress wherein you're going to be back in the minority again.
Right.
How are you going to adjust to that? What are your relationships? Do you find the relationships to the other side of the aisle with these trumped up Republicans that we have? How are you going to get along with them? How are you going to make it work?
Well, I think life is all about relationships, Fred. And some of the people, I would say out of the 28 new, you know, we gained one seat because of the census. So it's going to be 28 congressional seats. And out of that 28 congressional seats on both sides of the aisle, over the years of serving in the legislature for 17 years, some of those same colleagues are now in Washington. So to the extent that we can break bread and fellowship, we will, but I will not tolerate them trying to minimize or dissect or downplay working families' issues. I'm going to go and stand on 15 and a plus in terms of wages. We led the fight here in Florida when it came to raising the minimum wage. We put it in the Constitution and we also indexed it. So as inflation goes up, people's wages go up in Florida. So we're going to go and be that voice, not trying to grab the mic every other time, but letting them know that working people expect for us to take care of their business and not just at election time when you say you're going to work, because that's what the Republicans are trying to do. They're trying to say they're the face of working people. But when we get behind closed doors and we vote, we see a totally opposite direction. It's more on the corporate side. So I want to go and be that voice in Washington to elevate the conversation, because right now we are not on the table, so to speak, Fred. We're on the menu, and it's time for us to come off the menu and be at the table.
So do you see yourself, as far as national politics are concerned, and certainly, national politics is where you'll be. I mean, the Democratic Party has a progressive wing. Mm-hmm. It has a far left wing. And of course, it still has some moderates there, particularly in the House, who try to get things done. But there's that OAC wing and Bernie Sanders wing that keeps pushing the agenda, some of which just are not very appetizing to get passed. They haven't been able to get them passed, bottom line. Right. And some things that should have gotten passed and won't get any hearing in the Senate. So where do you see yourself falling in that analysis as far as congressional Democrats are concerned?
Well, I mean, some days we're going to be able to work with them, and some days we're not going to be able to work with them. I got to, first of all, put the constituents in the 4th district first. And then if there's opportunities for us to collaborate on some policy issues, specifically working families issues and working people issues, then I will join in concert with them. But if not, I'm going to continue to make sure that the gains that we have made as it relates to working families in the 4th Congressional District still stands loud and clear to them. I don't have a problem, Fred, over the years of being the one to push the red button and be the only one standing on the red button. I don't have a problem with that. But right now, our folks are too disconnected from us, and I want to connect us. And that's the policy I'm going to go up. About, like I said, again, we'll work where we can, and where we can't, we'll make a stand.
Issues. Even though it's not that big a deal here in Florida, as much of that, but we are looking at possibly having an open carry law passed here in Florida. It looks like it may come up sometime sooner or later. Where are you on guns and gun control?
Well, led some fights in the legislature about making sure that we had safety locks for guns in the home with children. I would say that I would probably be voting against that open carry because we were in the fight for stand your ground. Of course, I voted for stand your ground in the legislature, but I voted it on the premises that if, for example, I'm in Tallahassee, my wife was home and someone broke in, we don't have time to ask them what their Social Security number is.
Yeah, but by the same token, I mean, if you can go for stand your ground, but if you don't have a gun to defend yourself with, and the other person does have a gun, what good is
that? Running, hide. but you asked me about open carry.
All right.
Not for somebody walking around the streets with a gun on their side.
But wouldn't that deter a lot of
that would deter, but I just would not support it.
All right. Where are you on where are you on abortion rights? Right to choose, or are you pretty much are you looking at leaving the as a congressman, you'd be talking about a national issue. So are you into restoring Roe v. Wade or allowing states to choose?
I'm for abortion rights. And so look like if the Supreme Court makes that decision, there's going to have to be some rewrite into the legislation. I understand that the Senate tried to do something the other day, but they didn't have the vote. So I support abortion rights. And I would tell you that a lot of times I tell people, if you can't ovulate, you don't need to be regulating. So that should answer your question for you right there. It's amazing how men can spend so much time dictating on what a woman should do with her own body.
Well, that's because we've always done that, and that's the way our government was structured. I mean, let's face it, it was 130 years or so after the Constitution was put in place that they finally decided to, and they didn't decide, the country had to vote to give women the right to vote.
Right.
It still took another 150 years after that for them to decide to let African Americans vote freely.
Right. You got a point there. Well, we got, again, Fred, that's what happens when you get new people at the table. We can have a different conversation because it's not all men at the table.
Are you fine with the current congressional leadership in Washington? Are you fine with the current congressional leadership? Because even though you aren't as young as some of the younger ones are, you are still going to come in younger than most of the leadership that's in play. You're going to be at least 10 to 12 years younger than most of the leadership that's in the House right now that are leading things. So you think that there's about time for us to have a change of the gavel?
And I think that would be coming up on the agenda, Fred. I think that some of the folks that are in leadership now will be stepping back. Of course, we'll look at that when we get there. But I would submit to you that I'm going up there on a specific agenda of addressing the concerns of working people and working families. Mm-hmm. And if I can find a coalition within that leadership to do that, then I don't want to use it as an analogy, but I might have to become an AOC on my side of the house when it comes to working families and working issues to build that coalition, because I'm tired of us just getting lip service. Mm-hmm. And we are the backbone of this country when it comes to work and to keep the commerce moving, and especially in the state of Florida, because we are a service industry. By us being a service industry, workers should share in the benefit that these corporations are making. Whether it be gas prices that are going up now, these multi-million dollar companies that are leaving it up to Wall Street to come out with different formulas and stuff, but nothing is benefiting workers. Mm-hmm. Nothing is benefiting those folks that are paying by the rules. And what I mean by that is paying their taxes every year on April 15th or before. They should have a shake at a fair deal. And that's what we want to try to go do.
All right. Who's Tony Hill? Who is Anthony Tony Hill? You've told us a bit about it, but where have you served? Where have you done some time at? Who is Tony Hill?
Well, first of all, Tony Hill is a person that likes to connect people to the resources that they need in order to navigate the surroundings that they are in. For 8 years, Fred, we served in the State House. For 9 years, we served in the State Senate. For four years, I served under Alvin Brown's mayorship, where I was the federal policy director. For 5 years, I worked on Congressman Lawson's staff, where we were community organizers for that staff. So we have the breadth and the length of knowledge to go to Washington to continue on that same work of constituent services. Having someone to respond when they make that call to that office about their taxes return, their Social Security, veteran issues, educational issues, healthcare issues, housing issues. That's who Tony Hill would be for them, and I need their support in order to offer that up and be at the table. And it's time out for us just being on the menu.
All right. Excellent. Tony Hill, candidate in waiting at this call, at this time, candidate in waiting for the 4th congressional seat to the United States House of Representatives. You sound confident that it will, that the final call from the Florida Supreme Court will go your way. And we certainly look forward to you serving there. But either way, you're still going to be serving the constituents, because I presume that you'll still be working. If it goes the other way, you'll still be working with Congressman Lawson. If it goes your way, we'll be all looking for your name to show up on the ballot. And in either way.
Yeah. Well, Fred, as of the end of January, I'm no longer with the congressman.
Well, so yeah.
I've been off that staff for a few moments.
Yeah, but
again, though,
people still call you.
people still call you, and I'm also a faithful member of Greater Macedonia Baptist Church. So I see people in church all the time. Sitting here, come here. I need you to go down to the courthouse. I mean, it's all about connecting people and not correcting people. And that's what we want to do.
Amen. All
and
right,
we're ready for the fight, Fred. When the dust all settles, invite me back, and we'll give you an update.
Definitely. That's what I was going to say. We're looking to get an update on that, on where we are, the closer we get to it, because this is really going to be quite a time over the next few days. You expect something to happen within that, within really.
By next Friday, we should have some clarity and next steps. And as I told you before, we're trying to be proactive, not react.
All right. Excellent. Tony Hill, former senator for Florida, and former representative of the House for Florida, and a longtime associate of both former Mayor Alvin Brown and current Congressman Al Lawson. Thank you again for your time, Tony. We'll have you back.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you for it.
Next up, Fred's Reviews, a look at movie reviews that you might want to see. Cat Williams, World War III, released on Netflix. 7 of 10 stars. Not his best effort. For those of us who have followed the stand-up portion of Cat Sagas, this latest effort released on Netflix is not one of his better efforts. Cat spends a decent amount of time on current events, which we've come to expect. That's where the humor for this episode tends to be at its best. but his forays into sex and the parts thereof went a bit too long and might have made you smile, but the stories and his take on the human body parts simply didn't make you laugh. And that is what this is all about, right? Laughter. The rather weak ending to this stage performance was a good indicator that Cat simply did not have it all together for World War III. I love Cat, but I won't watch this again. Cat Williams, World War III, released on Netflix in 2022, 7 of 10 stars. And that's going to be it for this edition of Fred's Reviews and To My Way of Thinking. See you again next time.